السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد، وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلاما عليك يا سيدي يا حبيبي يا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. All praises due to Allah, the creator, the sustainer. Peace, blessings and salutations upon the greatest of his creation, Muhammad Rasulullah صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we will continue with chapter 3, in which services rendered before the announcement of the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Before the advent of Islam, the Arab people were infamous for internal fighting, with one of their most famous encounters being the War of Fijar. Every battle which occurred during the sacred months of Zulqa'dah, Zulhijjah, Muharram and Rajab were classified by Hurub-e Fijar, the wars of sin, as these were the respected months in which all fighting was halted and stopped. Believing it to be a sin, they would hang up their swords and put away their bows and arrows, though occasionally fighting would break out. The last war of sin which took place between the Quraysh and Qais tribes was when Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was 20 years old. He also participated in this battle with Abu Talib and his other uncles, as the Quraysh were correct. Though the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam did not strike anyone with his sword, his only action was to supply arrows in the battle. The Quraysh were first overcome by the Qais, but later they defeated them, which led to the end of the war. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, as we are learning in regard to the services rendered, one of the services was that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was supplying arrows in this battle, which was known as the War of Fijar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, he did not strike anyone in this battle with his sword, but was just supplying arrows. The continuous fighting between the Arab tribes was the cause of hardship for many families. There was no peace in the existence during night or day, and the lives and property of all were unsafe. In order to change this, a few sincere individuals gathered together after the end of Hurub-e Fijar to establish, after the war of sins, to establish a movement instrumental in bringing about some change in the society. The leaders of Banu Hashim, Banu Zuhra, and Banu Asad, etc., all assembled at the house of Abdullah ibn Judan, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's uncle, Zubair ibn Abdul Muttalib, son of his grandfather Abdul Muttalib. Zubair ibn Abdul Muttalib was also present, suggested an agreement which should be reached between tribes to control the vices that were inherent in the society. They agreed to live and let live and encourage what was said in the agreement as follows. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, they made an agreement in which they agreed to change the environment of the present to a more peaceful environment, to protect the travelers, to help the poor and destitute, to protect the oppressed, and not to allow the residence of an oppressor in Makkah, not to allow the residence of an oppressor, the one who does zulm in Makkah. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was also present in that gathering. That is the reason why we are mentioning it in the services rendered before the announcement of prophethood. Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam mentioned that this pledge was so dear to him that he used to say, after this has been mentioned, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to mention in regard to this pledge after the proclamation of prophethood, he used to say, I was very pleased with that agreement, and my pleasure in it would be greater than if someone had to offer me an expensive red horse. Even in this day of Islam, if someone uses this pledge to seek my help, he will surely be helped by me. What was the name given to this agreement? This pact was named Halful Fudul, as it was similar to a previous pledge which took place in Makkah amongst the Jurham tribe, because every person's name in it included Fadl. Example, Fadl bin Harith, Fadl bin Wada'a. Thus it was named so, literally meaning the agreement of the Fadl. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we find that all these actions were the agreement, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was part of this agreement. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the understanding of the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. When Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was 25 years old, he began to gain great reputation as an honest and trustworthy person. Allahu Akbar. At that time when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was regarded as an honest and trustworthy person. Before I go any further, it is very important for us that let us understand that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is 25 years old. He has not yet proclaimed that he is the Nabi of Allah, but two major elements were that he was honest and trustworthy. These teach us as the main elements of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. If we are Muslims and we claim to be Muslims, honesty and trustworthiness should be two major elements in the life of a Muslim, and that is why all the ulama emphasize that before the proclamation, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam made da'wah through his manners, made da'wah through his honesty and trustworthiness. That is why it is important for us as Muslims that if we claim to be Muslims, we should have honesty and trustworthiness in ourselves. At that time, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 25 years old, a very wealthy woman of Makkah, Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, whose husband has passed away, was in search of such a trustworthy person who could transport her merchandise to Syria for trade. She ultimately chose Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam because of the praise given to him by the people of Makkah, and said, if you take this for me to Syria, I will pay twice as much as I would have to anyone else. Allahu Akbar. Look at this, that before the proclamation of prophethood, trustworthiness and honesty were major elements, as I emphasized on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all Muslims to have honesty and trustworthiness in ourselves. Further, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he was approached and told that he will be paid twice as much as anyone else would have been paid, he accepted the proposition and traveled to Syria accompanied with a slave sent by Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha herself to be in his service in the name of Maysara. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam arrived in Basra, he camped with the caravan near a monastery belonging to a monk named Nastura. When Nastura saw the blessed face of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, he hurried to Maysara, whom he knew from before, and asked, "Who's that resting under the tree?" Maysara, who accompanied Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, replied, "He is the pride of the Banu Hashim who lives in Makkah. His name is Muhammad and his title is Amin." Nastura said, "Only a Nabi has ever sat beneath that tree. I firmly believe that he is the last messenger and can find signs of the final prophet, which I've read in the Torah, which has been revealed to Musa alayhi salam, and Injil revealed to Isa alayhi salam." Nastura mentions that he can see those signs which have been mentioned in the Torah and Injil. And Nastura further mentions that he hopes that he is present when he proclaims prophethood. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proclaims that he is the Nabi of Allah, he mentions that I can assist him dedicatedly for the rest of my life. Maysara, I advise you to serve him and never leave his company. Remember that Allah has made him Khatamun Nabiyyin. Nastura had said this. Why? Because he knew what were the signs mentioned in the Torah and Injil. We also learn in regard to the previous monk, when the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam took him to Basra, and Buhayra mentioned that he should return back selling all his goods. Why? Because the Jews are his enemies. And we find now, so what are we learning, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, that we are learning that not only were the signs of the Nabi of Allah only the signs not of the Nabi of Allah mentioned in the Quran, but the previous books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mention of the final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all the understanding of the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Whilst on his journey, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam fulfilled his duties in the markets of Basra and returned to Makkah without delay. As he arrived, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, while sitting in the upper portion of her house, while the caravan was arriving, noticed two angels giving shade to Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. When she saw this Nurani scene, when she saw this spiritual scene which stole her heart, causing her to become lost in the love of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha mentioned it to Maysara, who accompanied Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in the journey. A few days later, Maysara replied that she had seen throughout our journey, she mentioned that throughout our journey to Syria, we witnessed the very same thing. Not only that, but other strange incidents as well. She spoke of Nastura and the love Nastura showed, and the love he showed for Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha began to admire Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and decided to marry Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was a pious and was a pious woman whose reputation was untarnished, being referred to as Tahira, meaning the pure one, by the people of Makkah. She was now the age of 40 years old, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was at the age of 25. And she was first married, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, was first married to Abu Hala bin Zarara, from whom she had two children, Hind bin Abu Hala and Hala bin Abu Hala. These were the children from the first husband, whose name was Abu Hala bin Zarara. After he passed away, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha married Atiq ibn Aiz Makhzumi and gave birth to two further children, Abdullah ibn Atiq and a daughter, Hind bin Atiq. Following her second husband's demise, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha had been proposed by many dignified leaders of the Quraysh, but declined. After witnessing the prophetic mannerism and hearing of the events which took place in Syria, her heart became drawn to Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and she had decided herself to wed Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. This decision was made even after deciding not to marry a third time due to her age and rejecting the proposals of rich and powerful leaders. She called for Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam's paternal aunt, Hazrat Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha, who was married to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha's brother, Awam ibn Khuwaylid, and asked regarding the personal life of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam. Thereafter, how was the marriage proposal sent? The marriage proposal was sent through Nafisa bint Umiyya, and Nafisa bint Umiyya was the person responsible for taking the marriage proposal on behalf of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. And an authentic narrator of Sira, Muhammad ibn Ishaq, has recorded the actual reason given by Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha to marry the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. She mentions, "I became fascinated in you because of your excellent manners, in the honesty you displayed." Allahu Akbar. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we as Muslims today, we find our children getting married, but we do not look at honesty, we do not look at good manners and excellent manners as the main key and aspect of our children being happy. But we look at how big the house is, we look at how wealthy the bank account is, and we find that the marriages are not successful. Why? Because we have not used the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam as an example for us. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide guide our children. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to find the correct partners in the light of the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, inshallah. When the proposal was taken by Nafisa bint Umiyyah, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam then forwarded the proposal to Abu Talib, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and other elders of his family. How could they reject when the person in question was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha? They happily accepted the marriage with no objections and set its day. The Prophet took Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala an, Abu Talib and other family members and nobles of the Quraysh to the house of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha for the nikah to take place. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, before I continue, that when they go to the house of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and what takes place today in our marriages, we find that we do so many un-Islamic acts, and we are responsible for the breakages of the marriages. We are responsible for the arguments and fights in the nikahs and the marriages which are taking place. Why? Because of our un-Islamic acts. Why? Because when we have mixed gatherings in which women are exposing their bodies, showing their hair, which is totally haram and not accepted in the Islamic way of life. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, all our gatherings and all the functions which take place throughout the week, we find that we have music playing, and we find that men and women are mixing together. All these are a means of killing the blessings which are to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us in keeping our marriages according to the Quran and Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Abu Talib had delivered an eloquent speech when they went to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha's house for the nikah. He delivered an eloquent speech regarding his nephew, proving the exceptional character of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, displayed even before his announcement of prophethood. He stated, all praise is due to Allah who created us as the descendants of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam, and has made us upon the Mu'adh and Mudr tribes. He created the Kaaba and has placed us as its guardians and custodians, giving us leadership over people as well. This is my nephew Muhammad, son of Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala an. He is of such a standard that if anyone had to be compared to him in any field of comparison, he shall surely prevail. Yes, he has no wealth, but wealth, he has no wealth, but wealth is not constant. It comes and goes. After praising Allah, all present here are aware of my deep love for my nephew Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. He is marrying Khadija, daughter of Khuwaylid, with a mahar of 20 camels from me. Assuredly, he has a bright future ahead of him. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, we learn from what Abu Talib has said that wealth is something which comes and goes. But did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam have wealth? Why did Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha marry the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam? Set an example from the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Don't leave wealth as a main element of getting our children married, but look at honesty, look at the good manners, look at the trustworthiness, and look at the piety of Islam, piety which he has in regard to the Islamic aspects. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, Abu Talib mentions that the mahar of the nikah was 20 camels from him in the nikah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, which is something for us to know. After this, the cousin of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Warqa bin Nawfal, stood up to address the gathering. Praise be to Allah, he mentions, who created us as you have described. O Abu Talib, he has granted us these excellences spoken by you. Indeed, we are both the leaders of people. None can deny the nobility of the Quraysh, as we are happy to be united with you in this marriage. So I say to you, be witness that I have given Khadija, daughter of Khuwaylid, in the hand of Muhammad for the mahar of 400 mithqal, the nikah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha came to pass, and both began to live their lives in marriage. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was of the age of 40 years, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was 25 years old, and their marriage remained. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha remained with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam for a period of 25 years, and during her life the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam married no one else. All the wives which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam married was after the demise and leaving of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. His children were all from Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, except for his son Ibrahim, which we will discuss in the later chapters. My fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, all the children were from Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha sacrificed all her wealth for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and assisted the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam until her final breath. Detail of her life shall also be given inshallah when we go further. Summarizing what we have learned, we learned what we learned in regard to the war of Fijar and the war of sins and the agreement which was made to stop those, and how did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, why did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam go on his second journey to Syria, and how was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha lost in the love of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, how did the proposal go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi, for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and what had enticed, what was the reason that Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha sent the proposal. And we also learned in regard to the nikah ceremony, how simple the nikah was. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all Muslims to keep our nikah as simple as possible, following the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me for whatever mistakes I made during the discourse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me for whatever mistakes I made in narrating the Quranic ayahs, hadith, and the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive any mistakes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all to follow the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to perform our 5 times salah with jama'at inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us from this world with the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, wa ma tawfiqi illa billah, astaghfirullah wa akhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala وبركاته.